Carpenter family, the second week of Lent, we continue our time of worship and hearing from God's Word. Last week, we were challenged by Pastor John on the topic of repentance, and today we cover the topic of humility. And so as we gather together, let's prepare our hearts, and as we did last week, let's prepare our space around us as we enter into a time of worship. May you be blessed as we begin the second week in our Lenten journey.
My whole life I place and you came to my rescue, and I just wanna be where you
Greetings, Open Door family. This week's devotional is about humility. Now, maybe you're thinking, but of course you're not going to say it out loud, oh, humility? We always talk about humility during Lenten season. I know we should be humble during this Lenten season. I remember a sermon by a friend of mine many years ago, and he was talking about when he gives advice to his children, how they roll their eyes and say, "I know, Dad." For example, he might say, "You know, when you get a project at school, it's really good if you start right away instead of waiting to the last minute, and so you don't feel so stressed." And then he would describe as his daughter rolls her eyes and says, "I know, Dad." And then I remember him exclaiming, "You don't know." And I remember that well because as a parent, how many times have I wanted to get into the heads of my kids and say, "You really don't know." You know, oftentimes we don't even know what we don't know. We all have blind spots. And of course, you probably know where I'm going with this. I'm sure there's many times where God is saying, "You just don't know." You know, several months ago, or actually just 2 months ago at the new year, I was thinking about what should be some good goals or resolutions for this year. Now, I subscribe to an email by Bob Tied called Leading with Questions. And in one of his emails, he references a book entitled One Word That Will Change Your Life by Gordon, Britton, and Page. Now, I haven't read the book yet, but the gist of the email was, you know, instead of coming up with complex goals or resolutions for the next year, really, if you just focus on one word, it might just change your life. And so I thought about it and thought, hey, that sounds easy enough. Why don't I try that? And so I thought of one word for this year. And this year, the word I chose was listen. Listen. And so perhaps because I've been thinking a lot about listening lately, as I was preparing for this devotional, I realized that really listening is the pathway to humility. Let's look at our text for this week, Mark 10, 35 through 45. Mark 10, 35 through 45. Let me read it. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right hand and one at your left in glory." And Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you capable to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" And they said to him, "We are able." And Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." And when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant at James and John. And Jesus called them to himself and said, "You know, those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever will be great among you must be your servant, and whoever will be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Now, admittedly, there's a lot going on in this passage, and there's a lot going on in the context of this passage. In fact, as many of you know, just before this passage, Jesus tells his disciples, at least for the third time, that he's going to be killed and he's going to rise again. But you know, it's really difficult to know what the disciples were thinking. I mean, they must have heard him, but the question is, were they really listening to him? We know they must have heard him because, as many of you know, Peter's response to Jesus, that infamous response to Jesus. And then in the verses just before this passage, it says that the disciples who followed him to Jerusalem were afraid. So we know that they heard him, but the question is, were they really listening? It's also not hard to see how this passage addresses the topic of humility. But to really grasp the message that God has for us, the message that really transforms us, we need to dig a little bit deeper and really listen to what Jesus is saying. In the few minutes that we have, let me propose that there are two ways we really need to listen on our path to humility. First, we need to listen carefully to what God is saying about the way things really are. Listen to what God is saying here about the true nature of greatness. Is God saying that greatness is the opposite of humility? Actually, he's not saying that at all. Note that Jesus doesn't say that greatness is bad, or even seeking greatness is bad, especially when seeking greatness according to God. In fact, in our passage today, Jesus is pointing us to the epitome of greatness. He's pointing to the example of himself. Jesus, as the prime example of greatness, says, "Even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus, the God-man, already beloved by the Father, chose to walk this path of greatness. From Philippians 2, 5 through 9, we read, Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And the result of Jesus' humility is clear. We continue reading in verse 9. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. This is greatness. But in our passage, we read that the other 10 disciples were indignant at James and John, which means that they were angry at what they saw was unfairness or something that's unjust. Why should James and John get special treatment by just asking for it? You know, I can identify with James and John. I can identify with the other 10 disciples. Have you ever had a coworker or a classmate or even a sibling kind of maneuver their way to get special favor and it just seemed wrong or unjust? But Jesus is saying to all 12 of the disciples, all you guys are on the wrong path. If you want to be great, you need to follow my path. Jesus was and is great, and the path he was on was great. It would change the world. It would change the trajectory of your life. It would change the trajectory of my life forever. The path, of course, Jesus was on was the way of the cross. And so the message we need to listen to isn't be humble and don't seek greatness. The message is Jesus, who's been given the name above all names, chose the way of the cross. And that is how greatness is defined. But do we really believe that? Now, here's the thing. That's, of course, easier said than done. How can we persist in the way of the cross as Jesus did? We can only do that if we are secure in his love and commitment to us. If we are listening to what God is really saying to us, his beloved, because when we are treated like servants or even slaves, we need to know deep down that we are beloved sons and daughters, exactly because Jesus took the way of the cross for us. Jesus took the way of the cross for us. He is for us. Psalm 56:9 says, this I know, that God is for me. God is for me. God is for you. It doesn't matter if the world sees you as a servant or a nobody. They mock Jesus hanging on a tree, but God gave him the name that is above all names. Again, we need to listen to what God is really saying about true greatness. We need to listen to it and we need to believe it. The second thing we need to listen to on this path to humility is what people in our everyday are really saying as well. You see, you really can't serve people well if you're not listening to what they're saying. Whether it's your spouse or your child, a coworker, or an acquaintance on your child's soccer field, listening becomes the gateway to serving them well. Don't assume you know what they really need, because in fact, you don't know. Isn't it frustrating when you talk to a customer service agent that just assumes they know what your problem is? They think they know what your problem is, so they're not listening, and they're trying to find a solution that isn't really a solution to your problem at all. And yet, at the same time, it's so refreshing when you get a customer service rep that really listens to you and asks good questions, and they're looking for, they want to understand your unique problem so they can find the right solution. And it's such a relief. We've heard it before, listening is loving. Listening is a path to humility because it seeks to learn from the other person just as it seeks to learn from God. During this Lenten season, we want to learn to listen better. We want to listen to what God is saying to each one of us, to ask him clarifying questions, to consider the way of the cross that Jesus took and how we too can walk that way. We can walk that way exactly because we're convinced of his love for us, and we're convinced that it really is the true way to greatness. Also, we want to learn to listen to those around us better. Just because this is the holy season, we don't want to isolate ourselves from other people. Rather, seek to serve by listening first. Listen to the real needs of others, and then respond with the identity and the strength that God happily gives to you. I'm sure there are many times when God is saying to us, "You don't know." We don't know because we don't listen. Maybe we hear, but we really don't listen. We don't listen because we think we already do know. I want to encourage you during this season to spend time listening to God. Perhaps even ask him every morning, "God, what is it that I think I know, but I really don't know? Please help me to listen to what that is." And then lean into what other people are saying around you. Listen to how you can really serve them once you understand what their needs really are. Ask clarifying questions and then really reflect on how you can serve them better. So this season, consider listening as a pathway to humility. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much that you have shown us the way of the cross. And Jesus, who has the greatest name of all time, is the one that chose that way of greatness. Father, we pray that you'd help us to follow our leader in that way of the cross. And to do that by listening. Listening to you, what you're really saying is going on. Listening to you so that we really start to understand what we don't know. Father, also help us to listen to those around us, to learn what their needs are, and to learn to serve them well. Thank you, Father, for the privilege to listen. In Jesus' name, amen.